Hey everybody, it's Jim of Anime Educated, and today we have this episode.
There's nothing animator Frank Thomas likes better than sitting on a street corner watching how the world goes by.
I've been sitting here on the corner of Dopey Drive and Mickey Mouse Avenue. This is a real good place to watch people go by. Every artist has to go back to sources of inspiration. If he's portraying people as an actor or an author or an animator, he has to study people, what makes each individual different from the others. In our business, that's very important. In the 101 Dalmatians, we had the main dog, Pongo, was looking out the window at the women walking their dogs across the street.
Oh, well, I do say. Now, there's a fancy breed. Perhaps a little too fancy. Too old. Too young. Well, now that's a bit more like it.
Frank puts his observations to good use. They end up on the screen as animated characters you can really believe in.
That was the big thing to me, making the audience get involved in this and caring about what was happening to the characters. If you could get that, well then I figured, well, there's something to work on.
Frank Thomas worked on Disney Animation for 45 years. His heartfelt appetite for life went into every frame of film he drew. This is his story in the Disney Family Album.
Last week I had an episode about Ollie Johnston. This week I'm doing one about Frank Thomas, and both Ollie Johnston and Frank Thomas worked at Disney, and they came up with a book called Disney's Illusion of Life, which is definitely a must for you students out there that want to know about animation and how it works and what you can do and all that stuff. That's a really good book to have in your library of knowledge. So anyway, here it is, an episode from the Disney Family Album, all about Frank Thomas. Enjoy.
As the son of a school teacher from a small farm town, Frank Thomas had a no-frills upbringing.
I grew up in Fresno, which was at that time was a fairly small town. I was still associating with people who were close to the soil. And I've always felt that that makes a difference in your appreciation and in your feeling about humor and about animals and about people. You get down to basics of what kind of a person anybody is.
As an art student at Stanford University, Frank had his mind on a million things other than cartoons.
At the time I was going to school, I enjoyed the cartoons that were out, you know, the Mickeys and things that you'd see in the theaters. We liked them a lot, but I never thought of that as a profession because it looked like, it wasn't classy enough. I had ideas that I was going to be an illustrator, I was going to be an industrial designer, I was going to design egg beaters, I was going to do good things.
At that time, Disney Animation was improving with each new cartoon, and Frank recognized a dimension missing in his field of study.
The thing that had really attracted me to the Disney studios was this picture of the flying mouse, because that was the first time that I'd seen on the screen a character that drew the audience in, the audience identified with this character. You felt sorry for him. There was warmth, there was pathos in the thing. And I said, boy, if our cartoons can do this, this is a new type of thing. I'd be interested in working there because I always liked to draw cartoons. And so I went out to the studio, took the tryout, and got hired. $17 a week. Now, that was big money.
Although he was a college graduate, Frank found his real education was just beginning.
Almost immediately, this easy life that I'd been looking forward to of sitting there and drawing little pictures and laughing it up disappeared. Walt put us into art class. He put us into studying action analysis, looking at old films, studying characters, studying filmmaking, all of these things. And these are the things that appealed to me. Some animators felt that the drawing was the whole thing. If you drew well, that's all you needed. Others felt that you had to duplicate realism. That's what they were interested in. They wanted things exactly they were in real life. Others wanted to do something outlandish so that everybody would say, hey, who did that scene? Oh, yeah, I know, that's old so-and-so's scene. With me, I wanted the believable characters that the audience would care about.
After doing time as an in-betweener, The college-educated Thomas became an assistant to the great Freddie Moore, who was a natural-born animator.
Boy, I ruined a lot of Freddie's drawings. I didn't know that he was so good at that time. You know, I was a punk kid. Freddie was one of the best animators, the most natural animator that's ever been in the industry.
Down! Always chasing cats, Arch. Well, you're going to have plenty to answer for on your judgment day. Now lie down.
He had to feel right about what he was doing, and it took him quite a while to work up a head of steam. But once he was feeling right, he'd sit there in his chair and his feet wouldn't even reach the floor. He'd put them up on the wheels of the swivel chair and pull out another piece of paper and sort of humming. And in about an hour's time, without ever breaking his concentration, he would do as much work as someone else would do in a whole week. He was also the fellow who developed Mickey, gave him a new body. It's called the pear-shaped body because it can now do so many more expressions, so many more positions in the body. But he had this great way of drawing the things and working with him. I picked up a great interest in Mickey, too, so when I got a chance to do a big scene of him in The Brave Little Tailor, it was real fun.
Brave Taylor, I appoint you Royal High Killer of the Giant.
Giant? But your Majesty,
And your reward shall be 1,000,000 golden pazoozas and the hand of the fifth-ass Minnie.
Bubby, I'll cut him down to my size.
Another member of the Disney faculty, Norm Ferguson, taught Frank how to breathe life into a cartoon character.
He was the one who made Pluto think. And if Pluto hadn't been thinking, you know, none of the other characters would ever think. And the thinking was the most important contribution on the Disney animation. He never knew any restrictions on drawing. If he wanted the eyes to come way up off the top of the head, you know, for a big take, he'd draw them up there. He didn't know that eyes were supposed to stay on within the skull circle. He'd say, why?
Fergie's canine courses paid off, as you can see in Frank's animation for Mickey's Elephant.
Pluto's coming along and he sees this ball come out there and he wonders what it is. Well, as he goes down to sniff on the thing, the elephant sucks it with his trunk back under the fence. This makes Pluto very interested in the whole thing. This was the thought process, which was the key to making a believable character, getting the character to think and puzzle out a situation. And Pluto was ideal for this.
If you could animate Pluto by observing the everyday pooch, it was apparent to Frank that observing and analyzing human beings could lead to even more interesting animation.
I personally feel that you have to get out in the world and see people. You have to observe people. You have to watch what's going on and see in order to know what's funny about them. You have to argue with the insurance man. You have to argue with the salesman. You have to try to get rid of the old girlfriend.
Frank joined fellow animator Ward Kimball in forming the studio jazz band, the Firehouse 5+2. From his piano player's perch, Frank kept a keen lookout for characters.
It was very good for observing because, you know, the piano player is like the host. If you're playing a trombone, you know, you got something in your face and you can't really do anything. If you're playing clarinet, banjo is pretty good. Drummer's always too busy hitting things. But the piano player, he sits here and he smiles and he nods and he's looking around. And I'm looking for characters that I can use in the pictures. It was actually while I was playing in the band that I saw my model for the Queen of Hearts. She's sitting at a table over there and she was very autocratic. She figured she was the queen, but she was sloppy in her manners and sloppy the way she ate. And there's just something about it that was funny.
Oh. Who are you talking to?
Oh, a cat, Your Majesty.
Cat? Where?
There. Oh, there There he is again.
I warn you, child. If I lose my temper, you lose your head. Understand?
You know, we could make her really angry. Shall we try?
Oh, no, no.
Oh, but it's loads of fun.
No, no, no. Stop it! Oh, dear. Save the queen.
Someone's head will roll for this.
Frank also took his skill to the streets, where a busy intersection might turn out to be the animator's motherlode.
Did you ever notice how people, the different ways people cross the street or step off the curb, depending upon their personality, you get the real timid person who's afraid of... Now they're nervous the whole way. And occasionally you see an aggressive guy who thinks he owns the whole place. And he probably walks with his feet out and his arms out to his sides. And he doesn't care about anybody else. This is his street. By golly, he's going to enjoy it all. See here now. Then there's a preoccupied person, you know, who's got something else on his mind and doesn't even realize there's a street here. Gee. And one of the greatest walks of all was the one Bill Tytler did from Snow White, where Grumpy has been kissed by Snow White. He breaks away from her and very defiantly goes stomping off. Then he begins to mellow a little bit. He liked that kiss.
Frank, too, animated a walk in Snow White. A walk Walt Disney took and ran with.
The first sequence I had of any importance was where she was sending them out to wash their hands. In the story preparation for this, they had Dopey go the wrong way, and as he turned and came back, he was out of step, so he did a little hitch step to catch up. Also, I did the hitch step. Turned out all right, and Walt said, hey, that's a good trait for Dopey. Let's have him, every time he's walking anywhere, he has to do a hitch step to keep up. Well, within 2 days, I had every animator in the place coming in and said, it was your lousy hitch step that ruined my scene. I had that scene okayed for ink. That was all finished a month ago. Now I got to hold back and put in a hitch step. You. It wasn't my fault. It was in the story.
Hi-ho, 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 get home from where we go.
But humor was nothing new to cartoons. This scene, Frank's animation of the dwarfs gathered around a lifeless Snow White, made movie history. For the first time, audiences cried while watching a cartoon.
When the premiere came, everybody in Hollywood came out to see the thing. And I was so impressed because the people that I'd always admired and thought, gee, these are my gods, you know, they're so good, they wanted to meet me because I'd done something big. Back to the farm.
Walt Disney demanded even more of his artist for the second animated feature, Pinocchio. Of Frank Thomas, he requested life in a lifeless puppet.
Yes, yes, yes.
You couldn't have him professional in his what he did, because that would fight his character. He had to be innocent, but he had to have a few little things that he could do. Kind of like Stan Laurel, you know. Always had something that he could do that was kind of special and kind of magical. So I had him move in uncertain ways. He didn't know how to act. And even at the end of the thing, when everybody applauded for him, well, he thought it was fine, so he applauded right along, too. He didn't know the difference. And we tried to make a gag out of the fact that the hinge on his joints of his knees and on his head, he could spin all the way around in a circle.
Hey!
Sometimes to find the character he wanted to animate, Frank had to look no further than himself. He and Ichabod Crane shared a certain difficulty getting along with horses.
In most of my assignments, I have characters who are having the same difficulties that I do with in just every type of activity, especially with horses. I'm never that much part of the horse, and it's probably a good thing. The horses, first thing they do is go under a tree to brush me off. You know, if that fails, well, then they have other tricks. They're sneaky. When I was doing Ichabod, I had the same type of deal. I felt that he didn't know anything about horses. He'd borrowed this horse from a farmer, and the horse didn't care anything about him. And the horse was just sleepily going on home. He didn't even care whether he was in Sleepy Hollow, whether there were ghosts or anything. But Ichabod, he had this terrible apprehension about Sleepy Hollow. And here he had to use this horse. He would have been better off without a horse.
There was hardly any experience, or lack of it, that Frank couldn't make use of.
When we're working on Bambi, they had a sequence planned in story where Bambi and Thumper were on ice. Bambi had never been on ice before. I had heard that Walt was going to cut the sequence out because he felt that it slowed down the story. But at the time, I was trying to learn how to ice skate. And every time I'd come on a rink like this, you know, and go along very nervously, step by step, here'd be these other guys on their hockey skates, vroom, vroom, oh boy, vroom, 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 all around there, and just going around backwards, and da, 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 da. I said, that's the way Thumper ought to be, you know, and Bambi ought to be like me, going along here. Well, Mark Davis had done some wonderful sketches of all this, so using those, I showed Walt what we wanted to do, and he said, well, yeah, I guess so. So it was fun to animate the thing, particularly the Thumper part, getting him to act the way I always wished I could on skates. One of the most puzzling assignments I had was for Lady and the Tramp, where the two dogs were supposed to fall in love while eating a plate of spaghetti and meatballs. Looks pretty good. I wasn't sure that it would work, but I had two dogs, so I figured, well, let's observe what they do. Take a chance. Are you ready, dogs? Now, I want you to be the part of Tramp, and you're to be Lady. You're to be very nice about it. There you go. There you go. Now, remember, you're to give the last meatball to her. Don't eat the meatball yet. That's good. Very good dog. There. You ate the meatball.
If the real thing lacked that certain charm, the Thomas touch provided just the right romance.
For this is the night when the heavens are right on this lovely bed on water.
For Frank, liking his characters is as important as how he draws them.
The animator who does not like the characters is going to have a flat result. You have to really get into the character. You've created them. They're with you night and day for 2 years. You good. Better like them.
What are you doddering in this highlight?
Frank is the kind of guy who likes even the villains.
You have to really like them. And if they're a villain, you have to like certain aspects of their villainy. You know, like Captain Hook, the story man, Ed Penner, had seen him as a foppish guy, grand manners, you know, thought this is the way to live, midnight suppers, wine, all these gourmet connoisseur type things. That was the way he saw him. While the director saw him as a tough, mean guy who'd shoot the cannon and shoot his own crew on the ship, and he was a menacing villain. He was a menacing opponent for Peter Pan. Well, there was something to both sides, because if Peter Pan was to be the hero in conquering this villain, a guy who's very foppish here would not be effective. So you had to sort of come up with a character that would hold together through the whole thing.
Well, get on with it. Continue, my dear. I must harm Peter.
Madam, Captain Hook gives his word not to lay a finger or a hook on Peter Pan. Ah, Hangman's tree. So that's the entrance to his hiding place. Thank you, my dear. You've been most helpful.
Frank also animated the subtle but powerful evil of Cinderella's stepmother.
She was the force through the whole thing. She had to be believable. She had to look real to the audience, even though she was far from real. And she had to match in drawing Cinderella and the stepsisters.
To make the stepmother as believable as possible, Frank studied reference film of Eleanor Audley, the character's voice.
We dressed her up and we shot film of her, and then I'd study it and study it to try to figure out what part I could use and what part wouldn't work. But she was very good. She was austere when she had to be.
Now, let me see. There's the large carpet in the main hall.
Clean it.
And the windows upstairs and down.
Watch them.
Oh, yes. And the tapestries and the draperies.
But I just finished.
Do them again. And don't forget the garden. Then scrub the terrace, sweep the halls and the stairs, clean the chimneys, and of course there's the mending and the sewing and the laundry. Oh, yes. And one more thing. See that Lucifer gets his bath.
Frank once used the same technique with the voice of Mickey Mouse, Walt Disney.
Walt didn't want to be in front of a camera. And he said, well, finally, if you're in the booth way there and I can't see you and I don't know when it's going on, and well, I guess so, you know. So the day he wore a funny old busted-up hat and his oldest clothes, so he'd be real comfortable. When he recorded the voice, he couldn't help but feel this, you know, oh, you are you, aren't you? You know, all these little gestures. Because it's just spontaneous with him, you know. You could see that as a kid, he'd dream of himself meeting a bear, a big bear, you know. And what would he say?
It's you! That is, it is you! I mean, isn't it? I thought you were Pluto, but you're not Pluto. You're you. I'm Mickey Mouse. You know, Mickey Mouse?
And he put out his hand like this, and it was the only time we knew how big Walt thought Mickey was.
The Disney animators were the best in the business, and Frank credits the boss with making the best better.
You know, the most important thing in your life was pleasing Walt. Now, that wasn't because he was the boss or because you had any special relationship with him. He just had an air about him that you wanted to please this man. The other thing, which I think was even more important, was that he drew out of you what he thought, what he believed you could do. And he made you believe it, even though you said, I don't know how to do that. What am I going to do?
Frank found himself asking that very question while working on Mary Poppins.
Well, the problem we had was that Bob Stevenson, who's doing the live action, had been told, don't worry about the animation. You just get your part as good as you can. So when I'd get over on the stage, I'd say, where am I going to put my penguins? I'd say, this storyboard isn't going to work. And then they would all follow Dick Van Dyke around on the story sketches, you know. But as I'd get the film of Dick actually doing the dance, here's his feet flying all around, he's stepping on my penguins. And, you know, you animate a penguin, drawing after drawing after drawing after drawing, only to have it stepped on when it gets down here. How are you going to know ahead of time where he's going to be and where Dick Van Dyke's going to be? So I was losing more penguins every day. I had them duck, and I had them jump, and I had them get out of the way any way they could. But all of that worked. Walt was right. It forced us to be more imaginative, and we were able to come up with a result. It's quite different, actually, from what's on the storyboard, but I think it works well.
It's a jolly old day with Mary. Now wonder that it's
I remember one time Walt said to the story department, said, you guys all think that the world's made up of gags. There isn't one of you left who could write a lullaby or a love affair, a romance in a picture. You all want gags, gags, gags. He knew that you had to have warmth in your pictures for the audience to identify with them.
Frank never forgot this. His endearing characters became the heart of Disney animation.
This is the night. It's a beautiful night. And we call it Belle Morte. Look at the skies. They have stars in their eyes. On this lovely Belle Morte. Side by side with your loved one, you'll find an enchantment here. The night will weave its magic spell when the one you love is near. Oh, this is the night, and the heavens are right on this lovely Belle.
As the animator who always cared deeply for whatever he was doing, Frank Thomas loves animation because it pulls together everything he loves about life.
I'm not sure that I would have been satisfied just as a musician or just as an actor or just as something else. The fascinating thing about animation was it gave me a chance to use all of these interests, work them together, and they all helped each other. But I was very fortunate to be in the right place at the right time and to be able to live this kind of a life.
Just as you got
there. Great!
Well, I hope you enjoyed that, all about Frank Thomas. And if you did, you can press this button right here to subscribe to this channel and see more stuff. You can scroll down even, leave a comment below. Look at other past interviews and things that I have on this channel. It's pretty interesting. And I have these two videos that you might be interested in as well. So anyway, hope you enjoyed that. And we'll see you next time on Animated Educated.